And in 1639, he even started what's called the Sakoku, closed country policy, that lasted a while, 2.5 centuries of political unity known as the Edo period. And it ended the Portuguese influence after 100 years in Japanese territory. Nice try, guys. Obrigado for staying in Japan. But stop bringing your stuff that kill us. Now get out. You're too much trouble. もう来るな. Obrigado. Now let's look more closely at what happened during this time period in the Azuchi Momoyama period. During this time, Japan slowly unified under two powerful warlords, Oda Nobunaga and Toyotomi Hideyoshi. Oyasumi! Ohayou gozaimasu! Now, Oda Nobunaga is an interesting point in Japan's history and should be talked about in more detail. Oh good, I'm back. Yeah, I'm important and you skipped over me too quickly by killing me often. But in 1582, Oda Nobunaga suddenly came into the picture. Yup, me, and more me. Genki desu ka? And during the Battle of Okehazama, his army defeated a force several times its size led by the powerful daimyo Imagawa Yoshimoto. Now, Nobunaga was pretty cunning, known for his strategic leadership and his ruthlessness.
I'm a bad boy.
He further used the Christian religion to incite hatred towards his Buddhist enemies and to forge strong relationships with European arms merchants. He loved the muskets and trained with them with innovative tactics. I like God and guns. Buddhists suck. Now get out. And he recruited anyone who was talented and promoted them. He didn't really care about their social status like most of the other leaders did, and included his peasant servant Toyotomi Hideyoshi, who actually became one of his best generals.
Ooh.
Yeah, I was a peasant, but now here to kick your butt. What do I ichiban desu? During this period in Azuchi Momoyama in 1568, Nobunaga actually conquered Kyoto and thus effectively brought an end to the Ashikaga shogunate. He was super close in reuniting all of Japan in 1582 when one of his own officers, Akichi Mitsuhide, killed him, as mentioned earlier. This ends my part, I guess. Hideyoshi was actually pissed and avenged Nobunaga by crushing Akichi's uprising and emerged as Nobunaga's successor, and it was Hideyoshi that completed the unification of Japan by conquering Shikoku, Kyushu, and the lands of the Hojo family in eastern Japan. And now that Hideyoshi was the ruler, he looked over Japan and said, things need to change, time to tweak everything. So he decided to take away the swords from the peasantry, place new restrictions on the daimyos, persecutions of Christians, and a new law that effectively forbid peasants and samurai from changing their social class. You're born a peasant, you die a peasant. He actually started having thoughts of invading China, for Japan being called Wa in the past from China and not really liking K-pop. That joke was dead from the previous vlog. Not funny. Let's move on. And I like K-pop. And even launched two massive invasions of Korea starting in 1592. 안녕하세요. 감사합니다. 셰셰. 셰셰. But both attacks of China and the Korean armies had failed and ended after his death in 1598. The power got to my head. He wanted to form a new dynasty under his infant son, Yoritomi Hideyori, and asked his most trusted subordinates to pledge loyalty.
Could you please?
He's my son. Onegaishimasu. Yeah, okay, sure. But what happened right after Hideyoshi died was a war that broke out between Hideyori's allies and those loyal to Tokugawa Ieyasu, a daimyo and a former ally of Hideyoshi. Tokugawa Ieyasu actually won a decisive victory at the Battle of Sekigahara in 1600, which led to 268 uninterrupted years of rule by the Tokugawa clan. Enter early modern Japan, Edo period. Now, Tokugawa Ieyasu was the founder and first shogun of the Tokugawa shogunate. There is this kind of peace and stability during the Edo period where modern Tokyo stands today. Emperor Go-Yose declared Tokugawa Ieyasu shogun, and Ieyasu abdicated 2 years later to groom his son as the second shogun of what became a long destiny. I must have done a great job, my boy. Really turned out well. Now, learning from past history, the Tokugawa shogunate did their best to suppress social unrest, like crucifixes, beheadings, and death by boiling. Sounds pretty barbaric, but given past history, they felt it was the only alternative at the time. They even had punishments for the most minor offenses to instill absolute fear into its people. The criminals of high social class were often given the option of seppuku, self-disbowelment, an ancient form of suicide that became ritualized. The punishments were definitely not a time to be proud of.
Amma ureshiku nai na.
They even started to look at the Christian religion as a potential threat and completely outlawed it after the Christian-led Shimabara Rebellion of 1638. They even went as far as preventing further foreign ideas from flowing in, and the third Tokugawa shogun implemented the Sakoku closed country policy. And under this isolationist policy, Japanese people were not allowed to travel abroad, return from overseas, or build ocean-going vessels. Nothing to see out there anyways. Stay here. Enjoy being trapped. The only Europeans allowed into Japan were the Dutch, who were granted a single trading post on the island of Dijima. We are special. China and Korea were also the only other countries permitted to trade as well. But the first century of Tokugawa rule brought Japan's population to 30 million. Mostly because of agricultural growth. The city populations grew mostly in the rural areas, and literacy and the number of private schools greatly expanded. Some say it had the world's highest rate of education at the time, comparable to that of some European countries. During the Edo period of 1798, the samurai during this time had power and could kill a commoner for the slightest insult and were widely feared by the Japanese population.
Hey, we weren't that bad, just a little aggressive.
The merchant classes actually grew as well, especially in wealth, and began spending their income on cultural and social pursuits. They lived in this kind of world called the yukio, floating world. There were forms of theater like the kabuki and the bunraku puppet theater that became widely popular with short songs and music played on the shamisen, a new import to Japan in 1600. Haiku even developed, and the geishas formed a new profession of entertainment, providing conversation, song, and dance for customers, though they would not sleep with them, not to be confused with prostitution, which they were not. The Tokugawas divided society into four classes, and the samurai class followed the ideology of Bushido, meaning the way of the warrior. But later in the late 18th and early 19th centuries, the shogunate showed signs of weakening. Peasant unrest happened and taxes fell. Some of the samurai weren't even being paid and caused a lot of financial distress, and some side hustles had to be done to make a living. But it came to a point where they later rallied together to shut down the Tokugawa shogunate. Keep watching as to how.
I don't think you remember what happened before when you stopped paying us. Now pay up.
But the newly educated were bringing up new ideas and fields of study. Western learning, called rangaku or Dutch learning, were brought over with concepts of Western medicine and human anatomy. There is also kokugaku or national learning that pushed more of native Japanese values as well.
Yes, more knowledge, please.
But then something grand happened that changed Japanese history forever.